Our God, it's just so, so good to be gathered together. And we're so grateful, Lord, for this opportunity to meet from across our diocese and from different churches, to have some of our parish readers with us this evening. And Lord, to be together, to meet with you above all else, and also just to be together and to meet one another. And we pray, Holy Spirit, come and fill this place with the beauty and presence of our holy God. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. We love your presence. We love your truth. We love your word. And we love your Son, the Lord Jesus. Would you place his name upon our lips this week? And Lord God, would you write your word upon our hearts and lives this week? And Holy Spirit, would you come and fill us again with your presence and love and power and grace and goodness? And would you equip your church in these days to rise up and, Lord, to usher in your kingdom, your authority, your rule. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, I have some idea of the amount of effort that goes into the preparation of whoever hosts this week, so I want to thank the folks here and the rector, the Reverend Clive Atkinson, for all the preparation that's gone into just making us welcome and making us comfortable this evening. I'm going to read just a few verses and then we're going to stand and worship the Lord together. Please stand as I read these verses from one of our Psalms, Psalm 145. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in season. Come and nourish us. Come and meet with us. Come and feed your people, so that we might love you more. And because we love you, we would tend your sheep and care for your lambs. In Jesus' name, amen. An opening song of worship.
Lord, I come when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand has made. I see the star, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I see that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, well, I scarce can take it. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
Then sing.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me. How great thou art. Amen, amen. Please take your seats. Friends, it is, I really do believe it, an exciting sort of moment for the church and for all of us as we move forward. The phrase that I've been using to sort of describe this season is not that we restore things to where they were, God forbid that, but we reboot the church for a new season of mission that lies ahead. Now, I'm very, very thankful that John and Anne have been able to be with us. They're here at considerable cost to themselves, and that Anne, that John's sister died just a couple of weeks ago. And he was to be with us sooner, actually, for the retreat for those who are being ordained. But John, we're so, so grateful that you've both managed to be with us these days. And we're very, very thankful to the Lord for that. Let's welcome John and Anne in a truly down and remorse sort of way. There are a number of things that each evening I just want to take a couple of very brief moments to mention that fit in with our vision and our direction as a diocese as we move forward. First of all, we put in place 5 training evenings for small group leaders, for Bible study group leaders, for house group leaders. And those training evenings will soon be running. Josh Hooker is the man. Josh, would you please stand? Josh has just recently joined us, come all the way actually from Namibia to be with us and to work here among us. So Josh, he will be around to talk to you afterwards about these training evenings. You'll find the details on our website, and people from parishes can book by going on to Eventbrite to book. Secondly,
we put in place an evening to equip those who will run Alpha courses. In Northern Ireland, every year, there's about 300 Alpha courses. We want to see the church growing, not by people just moving from other church congregations, but through conversion. We do believe that people really need to be converted to Christ. That's how lives are changed. That's how the kingdom of God is built, when people come to know Jesus and cross over from a place where they don't know him to knowing him. And one of the tools that God is using in that is Alpha, and there will be a training evening on the 22nd of September that Johnny Campbell, who runs Alpha in Northern Ireland, will be looking after. That will happen in Knocknagony Parish Church. It's very easy to get to off the M3. Good to have parish readers with us this evening, and there'll be a new batch of training in the new year for a new lot of parish readers as well. And then to say as well that we're currently recruiting what we're calling apprentices, young adults who will be released into parishes to learn how to do ministry and to be trained and equipped and to work and to serve in a local parish context, but to be discipled as well during that apprenticeship year. And we're calling this new program Forge. And again, there's details about that on our website. And our other Josh, our youth officer, and Andrew Branigan will be able to point you towards how to discover more if there's someone in your parish that might be a candidate for all of that. And I've just one more notice, okay? I'm really trying to get through them quickly and clearly and as helpfully as I can. And we're going to worship now. We're going to have a number of songs of worship together. And during the first of those songs, an offering will be taken up. And I want to tell you what the offering is for each evening at our Bible Week this year. During lockdown, we actually planted three new congregations, one in the village of Dundrum, one in Tullycarnet Estate on the edge of Belfast, and one in the West Winds Estate in Newtownards. And the next church plant, probably, unless there's another one before the next one, but the next one we really hope will be one that will focus very much on migrants and on refugees. We're told from government officials that over the next 10 years or so, our diocese is going to be the place in Northern Ireland where there's going to be a lot of refugees moving into. We want to be ready for that. We want to have a church plant in, I'm not saying where, but it's going to be not far from here, but not in this parish, okay? We're beginning to put together the funding to enable that to happen. We have been working on that quite hard. And I think that it's fitting that I'm asking you to do that on the evening where 1 year ago today, we watched the Taliban retake control of Afghanistan. 1 year ago today. And we welcomed, in a very speedy sort of way, some refugees, not enough, I would say, from that nation. And we've been welcoming refugees from other nations, including the Ukraine, since. And I know that parishes have been engaged in that. But we really want to focus in on that. And the offering this week will go towards that. I think that's enough by way of information for this evening. Please stand. I want to encourage us as we worship, really, please let's press into the Lord. The scriptures tell us that the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. Lord, I pray that as we worship, your Holy Spirit would fall, and that our hearts would be set on fire with a deep, deep hunger for more of you and for who you are. And that, Lord, our love for you would become stronger and deeper, and our love for your world wider.
and Lord, more concern for those that don't know you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing, but not. Try to hide. It was my truth till I met you. Call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness to your glorious day. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I need a shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I breathe in. I have a future, my eyes are open. When you call my name, I ran out of that grave. that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has broken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings holds me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Set me free, hallelujah. That was lost, it's grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Amen. Amen. Jesus. 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 Can I ask that we just speak out his name, the name Jesus? Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Lord, I pray that your name would be on our lips. Lord, that your truth would be in our hearts and in our lives. And Lord, that we would, in the power of your Spirit, discover again and again and again how and why and just the significance of speaking out the name Jesus. Lord, may we never, ever, ever be ashamed of your name. We love your name. We love who you are. Jesus. 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 Friends, we need to hear his name often as we worship, as we preach, as we pray. His name is precious. Never be ashamed of his name. Amen. I'm going to ask the parish readers to remain standing and everyone else to take a seat. And if the parish readers would find their little running order with this simple, brief act of recommissioning this evening. And can I say, as we do this, there will be the opportunity for parishes to put forward others for training to become parish readers. Parish readers lead worship, they lead prayer, they read God's word, they assist in local parishes. They assist in their own local church. And it's a privilege to speak his word out. It is a privilege to pray in his name. I want to ask all of you to surround them and others in prayer as we go through this little simple act of me giving them, as it were, a fresh charge. We're emerging into a season where we need to be about God's business of mission, and we need every hand to the plow. So we greet you in the name of Christ. Who are you, and what do you seek? What is the service to which you are called? With what confidence do you undertake this ministry? Let us then humble ourselves before God and together seek his mercy and his strength as we journey on, holding before him in honesty our weaknesses, our failures, our brokenness, sometimes even our cruelty to one and another, our offenses and our sinfulness. Please be seated, and we're just going to have a moment of stillness and quietness together. These are days when all of us, bishop and people, I think, could do a lot worse than just spend time searching our hearts and allowing the Lord to cleanse and wash us clean, times in repentance, times in humility, times seeking more of God's mercy and grace. I'm going to ask all of you to join with the readers in a moment in this simple act of penitence. Together, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The response at the end of this, if it doesn't appear in the screens, is we will support them. We will support them. Conscious that parish readers are called to lead us into a deeper experience of God's presence, will you support them in their calling?
We will support.
I'm going to ask the readers to remain standing and everyone else to just take a seat. And Lord, I pray for each of these readers, thanking you for them, but praying, Lord, that there would be above them, as it were, an open heaven, and that you, Lord, would pour out upon them every blessing that you see to be needful for them, every grace, every sense, Lord, of being able to listen to the voice of your Holy Spirit, the anointing, Lord, and equipping for all that you call them to and will call them to, and the more that you will lead them into in the days that lie ahead. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Lead others into God's presence. Enable others to hear God's truth and God's word clearly spoken over them and to them as you read from his word. And lead others in intercession that moves the hand of God and that cries out to him for our world and for our church. And be blessed. Do it all for his glory. And do it all with thanksgiving and with joy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please take your seats. Friends, we're going to, at this point, have one of our readers come. Robin's going to come. We've given him a really easy reading for this evening with no difficult names. It's not a test, Robin, wherever you are, but come and read for us this evening the first of our scripture readings.
Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 1 to 12. Ezra reads the law. In October, when the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people assembled with a unified purpose at the square just inside the water gate. They asked Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given for Israel to obey. So on October 8, Ezra the priest brought the book of the law before the assembly, which included the men and women and all the children old enough to understand. He paced the square just inside the water gate from early morning until noon and read aloud to everyone who could understand. all the people listened closely to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on a high wooden platform that had been made for the occasion. To his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. To his left stood Deah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hazem, Hasbadaram, Sikariah, and Meshulam. Ezra stood on the platform in full view of all the people. When they saw him open the book, they all rose to their feet. Then Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people chanted, Amen, Amen, as they lifted their hands. Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Benai, Sherebiah, Jemin, Akim, Shabbathai, Hodiah, Maaseiah, Kelalida, Azariah, Josabad, Hannah, and Peleah, then instructed the people in the law while everyone remained in their places. They read from the book of the law of God and clearly explained the meaning of what was being read, helping the people understand each passage. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra, the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were interpreting for the people said to them, Don't mourn or weep on such a day as this, for today is a sacred day before the Lord your God. For the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. And Nehemiah continued, Go and celebrate with a feast of rich foods and sweet drinks, and share gifts of food with people who have nothing prepared. This is a sacred day before our Lord. Don't be dejected and sad, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And the Levites too quietened the people, telling them, Hush, don't weep, for this is a sacred day. So the people went away to eat and drink at a festival meal, to share gifts of food and to celebrate with great joy, because they heard God's words and understood them. Thanks be to God.
And I again just welcome John and encourage us to pray for him as he brings God's word to us this evening. I'm going to ask you to do so. I'm going to ask you to put one hand, as it were, in your heart and reach another hand towards John as a way of saying, look, we're taking responsibility this evening for actually hearing and receiving God's word. We're not putting it all on this man, but actually we're here to hear and to receive. So Lord, we do pray that our hearts would be hungry and open and ready to receive from you. And Lord, we pray just a fresh anointing on John and the word that you've given him. Stir it up in him, Lord. Make it live to us. And Lord God, in your mercy, would you transform your church? Would you transform your church? As we just yield ourselves to you and to your truth. Come, Holy Spirit, work in us that there might be a work done for your glory. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, David. Thank you for your welcome, everybody. It's a pleasure to be back here. My first visit to this church building was actually just after David had been appointed as the vicar of Willowfield. It was nothing like it is now in this present shape, warmth, welcome, and degree of modern apparatus to make worship something that is quite different from what it may have been historically. But the object of our worship is still the same. He is still the Lord. He is still faithful from generation to generation. And to see a church full like this must be similar probably to many times in the history of this church building, even if not in the recent history of many church buildings around Northern Ireland. Because we live in a time, sadly, of relative famine, both of the Word of God and hunger for the Word of God. So by and large, our church buildings are relatively empty rather than relatively full. But I want you just for a moment, literally, to look around this building tonight. Look around. That means not forward. It means look around. If you can't see the back, if you're at the front, stand up and look at the back. There are people in almost every seat in the building. Now think your church building. Now you picture your church building. In your mind's eye, look at every empty pew and imagine it filled with people hungry for the Word of God, hungry for the presence of God, hungry to be a people empowered in mission with God. Well, I thought that might get you excited, but obviously. Thank you for reading that passage so well. That's a real test of any reader, isn't it? I don't know whether you noticed the difference between the role of Ezra, who had a relatively easy job of reading, and the role then of the rest of the Levites, who had to explain what was being said. And my goodness, they were people of stamina, weren't they? From early morning till noon, that was probably about 6 hours standing, listening. It's no wonder when the worship began, they all fell on their faces, isn't it? Now, here we are. Let's just say what we're trying to talk about this week, and then we'll get into the message for tonight. Forward Together is the title I felt that the Lord's stirring in me, and you might ask the question, why? So what I want to say is that this is because, in my understanding, God is always on the move, and he always moves forward. He doesn't move backwards. He takes what has been and always moves forward. And if that is his posture in the world today, that needs to be our posture as individuals, as churches, as dioceses together. Forward together. You see, next slide. History is his story. We're caught up at this moment in our lives almost as if, for everyone, each of us, as if we are the center of the universe. And really, none of us are. We know that. But actually, we almost live as if we are. Or our church, or our particular culture, as if this is really where everything is happening, must happening. And actually, God has been there from the beginning and will be there at the end, not just in Western culture, but in every culture under the sun. God is, has been, and will be. And so it's the art of living the Christian life is seeing what God is doing and joining in. So what is God doing and what can we join in? I've chosen for these 4 nights a Bible passage each time, which is not about an individual's encounter with God. It is about a group or a church or a community or a nation's encounter with God. And I want us to think as a nation or as a church or as a diocese encountering God, I am part of that encounter. I am empowered by that encounter. It is about me, but it's also about us together. As always, we have a supreme example, our Lord Jesus. So next slide, he says, in John 5:17, my Father is always at working, and so am I. He always had his eyes on what the Father was doing. In fact, he says, I can only do what I see the Father doing, and I can only say what the Father gives me to say. Being in step with the Spirit is the key to living the Christian life. What is God therefore doing? He is doing what he's done in every generation, in every continent, of the whole world, always. He's winning, wooing and seeking to win people back into a relationship with him, their creator and their would-be father. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believeth in him, and I'm sure you're all joining in with me because this is the most famous verse in the Bible just throughout, so that whoever believes in me should not perish but have everlasting life. God is seeking to woo and to win the world back to himself. That's what he's always been doing. That's what he always will do. Jesus, it says, having loved his disciples, he loved them to the very end. That's how he lived his life day after day after day, seeking to love people back into relationship with Father God. And one day the end will come. I mean, we not many of us live our lives daily with the expectation of the possibility of Jesus suddenly appearing to wrap the world up. Do we? Hands up if you've done that today with great expectation, 24 hours, of the last 24 hours. It's not a common thought that while we're in the midst of life, suddenly death will arrive or Jesus will return. And my sister's own sudden death 2 weeks ago was a real wake-up call for part of the extended family who've never really thought about the reality of death coming soon. We all need to live our lives with looking well ahead rather than just at the next day or at the next week. I believe unless we have our eyes on the future with death in mind or with the return of Jesus in mind, we're actually going to go wrong on the path of life. I was mowing my lawn on Saturday afternoon, probably for the first time in 7 weeks. It's been a wonderful thing, this gift of sunshine, for all people who find mowing the lawn hard work. As I was mowing it, trying to get a straight line from where I started at one end of the lawn to the other end of the lawn, I fixed my eyes on the distant point, and I just kept my eyes on that point. When I looked down to see whether I was keeping on the right line, I suddenly realized I'd drifted off to one side, and I lifted my eyes up again. I thought, oh, got to correct that. Keep going straight on. If we want to follow the straight course of life that Jesus has designed for us to walk on, we've got to have an awareness of the future rather than just a sight on the immediate present. And this is what Jesus says. He says, next slide, the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all nations will hear it, and then the end will come. Let's keep our eyes on the distant future as well as the immediate present. And if there are some tonight who aren't sure when they meet the Lord face to face of what their future would be, this is a night to make sure. So the first passage in this week I'm looking at is the book of Nehemiah, as we've just had read, and I've given it the title, Revelation Becomes Revolutionary. When God reveals himself, when he breaks into our life as we're in the course of our everyday life, or even when we're in the course of meeting together with other believers in worship, when God reveals something, it's revolutionary. So you'll recall Jesus having a conversation with his first disciples, saying to Peter and the others, who are people saying I am? He's really saying, how am I getting on? Is my message getting across? And they give him the best story so far. So the best story so far is you're prophetic. And then there's a bit of elaboration, really. You know, some are even saying you're John the Baptist, come back to life again. I mean, that's a bit sort of left wing, isn't it, really? But then Jesus turns to them and says, who do you say that I am? And you all know Peter's response. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now then Jesus responds, flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, Peter, but my Father in heaven has revealed it to you. The reason Peter became the first disciple to recognize and articulate that Jesus was the Son of the living God, the Messiah, the only one in whom there was hope for the world, the reason he believed was because Father had revealed it. That's why we're praying, Father, open heaven, reveal yourself, speak through Scripture, speak by your Spirit, keep speaking, revealing yourself, pray of God. And whenever God does that, something revolutionary, life-changing happens in our personal lives or in a church community or through a church community, happens in the wider community or even in the nation. Let's not lose sight of the nation, friends. We're not really talking about filling up church buildings. We're talking about the nation being saved and the nation being changed. So revelation becomes revolutionary. Let's look at what actually happened through the 6 hours of standing and the careful explanation. The next slide. Revelation, first of all, is for everyone. it is intended that all people of all ages, of all backgrounds, actually have the chance to be introduced to the living God. And that is actually the way in which you as readers, you as church members, are thinking, I hope and pray, about your church. Are we giving everyone in the building and outside the building, in our community, the chance to hear the word of the living God? And when they hear it, to have it explained to them if they don't, first of all, understand it. I'm encouraging you as readers, whenever you read or lead a service, to do it with feeling. Don't try to be dispassionate. How can we be dispassionate about a God who's passionate? That's the non sequitur, isn't it? If God so loves, it's got to be apparent that we're caught up with that God of love in such a way. When we're speaking or leading, whether it's liturgy or whether it's prepared sermons or whether it's ad hoc notices, that we're actually appealing with the same love that the Lord God appeals to us. Revelation is for everyone. Revelation next leads to worship. They bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. It says they raised their hands and then they bowed down. I wonder whether we should do a little bit of energetic exercise, practicing that, raising hands, bowing down. I mean, you're being a very good Anglican congregation tonight. Very different from what was happening then. You see, when God breaks in, people respond in a way that actually they may never have premeditated. It's just that they're caught up in response to the presence of the living God who loves them. How can we ever be the same when that's the case? If you read the stories of revivals, that is actually what happens in moments when groups of people together meet with God. Here's a story from the Welsh revival. This is what it says about what was happening at the time. A common scene is that of visitors being turned away. In other words, there was no room for them at these revival meetings. But upon arriving at a meeting, you would barely have any standing space, as a place is packed to the brim with people hungry to receive from the Lord. It wouldn't be long before you hear pockets of saints lifting their voices in beautiful melodies. The sound of their voices would cascade across the room until the whole place would erupt in thunderous praise. Occasionally, one would stand to seek prayer for an unsaved loved one. The singing would segue into intercession as loud cries of mercy, mercy, mercy rise to heaven like incense. And after a series of urgent prayers, the Spirit would lift the burden of the meeting, and the meeting would transit seamlessly into the next session as the invisible hand of the Almighty Conductor himself orchestrates and directs the order. Tears of joy and gratefulness would roll out uncontrollably as he speaks of his divine encounter, as the meeting once again is crowned by a symphony of praise. Are we praying for such revival, revolutionary encounters in our churches? Readers, church leaders, members of vestries, please don't be too controlling. When God comes into the house, it's revolutionary. Let revolution happen, as it was for the people of God then, as it was for the revival in Wales. Let it be so again in Northern Ireland. But revelation often needs explanation, and that's what the Levites came in. After the Bible had been read, they had to explain what was really happening or what it was that God really required. The Levites, it says, clearly explained the meaning of what was being read. You know, when God breaks in, people have experiences, and they then seek, very often, people who they think will be able to help them. The people they seek are normally, they think, a chapter or two ahead of them in the book. And that's actually normally all it takes, to be a chapter or two ahead. Our friend David Pictures used to say, in the country of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. In other words, just being able to see a little bit more than the person you're trying to bring understanding to is the important thing. Anyway, so in lockdown, in lockdown. I mean, what a thing we've come out of. Incidentally, what you might ask why I've chosen Nehemiah as the first passage. One is because they had been in exile for 70 years. And then over a period of 70 years, three groups of people came back from Babylon into Jerusalem and began to farm again. Then they began to build the temple. They completed the temple. And then Nehemiah comes to build the walls around the city. Nehemiah is actually in secular employment, which is why I thought it'd be good to have readers in secular appointment to hear this particular passage. So your skills on the one hand, but your concern for the people of God come together in this. He was actually in the king's security guard. It says he was cupbearer to the king. Well, one of the roles of the cupbearer was to make sure nobody put poison in the cup to poison the king. So he's a security guard. Anyway, he is equally involved and concerned for the people of God. And I'm also doing this because this is coming back out of exile. And in a sense, COVID has put the people of God into exile from being together. We're coming back out of that to be together. And it's happening a bit in dribs and drabs, just as it was for the people coming out of Babylon back to Jerusalem. But it will be, when we all come together, there will be incredible encounters with God, I think, that will be literally life-changing, revolutionary for the individuals, for churches, and then subsequently for communities. So in COVID, in our church back in North London, the vicar gets a call one day. It's from somebody he doesn't know at all. The phone call, the person on the phone simply said, "Vicar, can I be baptized?" Well, that's an interesting question. I don't know how many church leaders there are who've had phone calls like that. He immediately says, "Oh, that's an interesting question. I'd love to baptize you. Tell me why you're wanting to get baptized." So the woman says, "Well, I'm a Muslim, but I've been having visions of Jesus and conversations with him, revelation. And I went to speak to a friend who's a Christian, and this Christian friend said, 'Well, if you're a Muslim and you've been having visions of Jesus, you're really a Christian. You ought to be baptized as a Christian, because if you don't get baptized as a Christian, then you're going to go to hell.'" That was her explanation. So she decided she'd better ring up the vicar. So the vicar says, "Well, I would love to baptize you, but, and you know, tonight we've actually got it's one of the nights on the Alpha course that we're running in our church. That's an introduction to people who are seeking faith in Jesus. And tonight is about who is Jesus, so why don't you come along?" So she came along that evening, and it was all about Jesus, as explained in the Alpha course. He was either mad, bad, or God. How many of you have done the Alpha course? Just raise a hand. Quite a lot of you. So you remember that evening. It's either he's a mad, bad, or God. So the vicar says to this woman, after the Alpha course is finished, "How did you find it tonight?" And she says this. She says, "Well, you know, you don't need to prove to me about Jesus. I've been having conversations with him every day for the last few months. I know him already. All I really want to know is how can I know more and become part of the church?" Explanation needs to be clear and actually truly biblical for the revelation that people are already having in their lives. Statistics show that actually out there, although in here there's only a very small percentage of the population in churches, out there there's a much higher percentage who believe in some supernatural being or believe in a God or have had supernatural encounters that they need explanation for. Friends, that's what God is calling us to do with the people around us. Explain to them the encounters that they're already having. Next slide. Revelation sometimes will produce great sadness, such that it has to be said, "Don't mourn or weep on such a day as this, for today is a sacred day before the Lord." For the people had all been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Why do you think it was that people were weeping? It wasn't that they'd been going for 3 hours and they knew there was another 3 hours to go before noon and the reading stopped. It was probably, "Well, why have you been sad in worship sometimes?" I've been sad in worship sometimes for a number of reasons. Sometimes it's to do with my own emotions that somehow come to the surface in worship. And when you're experiencing pain and difficulty in life, you find yourself in the presence of God and you know he loves you and you start to weep and it's a bit of a release thing. But sometimes it's because you've been convicted by the Holy Spirit. He's showing you stuff in your life that you can't really hide from a holy God. And you know you're in the presence of a holy God and you weep over the sin in your life as the Holy Spirit exposes it. Or you weep over the consequence of your sin, which is you realize that you've missed out on the blessing of God because you've kept him at arm's length because of your sin. And I think that was a lot of what was going on in this occasion, because the whole law was read, which means that God was saying how great he is, how much he loved his people, how close he wanted them to be. And they realized, oh my goodness, Lord, we've missed out on what you've got to offer because of our own lack of love for you. And so it was with great that sadness sort of was surfaced in their lives as they saw the goodness of God, because they knew they'd missed out. And so within that, it has to be explained that this is not a moment to wallow either in your shame or to be kept in your shame. I know it is relatively easy to keep people in shame in church. I can start talking to you right now about a number of different things. Men, your thought life and what you've been looking at recently. Men are feeling ashamed. Everybody right now, your prayer life. You ought to be praying more than you're praying. Everybody right now, when did you last lead someone to faith in Christ? I've made shame. I've placed shame on you straight away. We all know that we're not doing enough of the latter two, and we're probably doing too much of the former first. This is not a moment to be trapped in our shame or to be trapped by others in our shame. That's what they had to explain to the people. When they began to weep, there was a moment for weeping, but there's a moment for release from that. What a great song it was that we sang a few moments ago, that we could not bear the weight of the shame, but then that we were set free by the Lord. And that's actually what an encounter with God and a moment of a group encounter with God is meant to be about. And it can happen that some people are weeping at the same time as some people are being set free. So you can have weeping and laughter at the same moment in such encounters as this. And for those of you who lived through outpourings of the Spirit, as I have now seen a number of outpourings of the Spirit in my life, that was one of the most confusing things when I first saw it happen. How come that people can cry and other people can laugh all at the same time? It's because of exactly this thing. It's revelation from God, and some are getting the first conviction of the Holy Spirit, and some are getting that moment of release from it, which comes when you encounter the forgiveness and the true love of Jesus. And so the Levites have to explain to them, go back and feast, go back and rejoice, take this. Now, many of you will know the name J. John. Do you know J. John, a great evangelist? And he once at New Wine, the conference that I've been involved with for the last many, many years, he did a little thing about the way in which people come up to receive communion. And, you know, they come up very solemnly in the Anglican Church, and they queue up very solemnly, and they put their hands out very solemnly, and they take their bread and wine very solemnly, and they're very solemnly sort of feeling the weight of their sin upon themselves and just demonstrating, in a sense, their unworthiness to come and receive. And he said, what an extraordinary thing is that we think that is the only way to receive communion. It might be a way. Yes, thank you. Why do we not express joy when we receive the sign of that forgiveness from the Lord? It means we don't have to be bowed down by shame, no longer trapped by the accusations of the enemy, but actually embraced by the loving Father, filled with the Spirit and empowered to go out and tell others, this is good news. It's not really bad news after all. Sorry, thanks to J. John, with a little bit of adaptation probably. So that's basically what happens for 6 hours. I'm not going to go on for 6 hours. You'll be relieved that there were only 5 books in the Pentateuch, the book of Moses. And I'm not going to speak from all 66 books of the Bible. I'm only going to speak from 5. But I want to highlight some of the revolutionary things that are released by true revelation. One from each of those first 5 books. So first of all, you know the phrase that the Jews used to say, my father was a wandering Aramean. Next slide. God is always on the move. My father was a wandering Aramean. That is my heritage. Jesus was always on the move. It says in Genesis chapter 1, God's word to Abraham, leave your native country, your relatives, your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. There's a call on the life of every individual and every church to move on from where they are, to go to the people that God chose them, to make a home amongst those people, and amongst those people to share the love of God. That is the nature of our God. We cannot build buildings and stay inside buildings. The church is not a building, it's the people. The church is not just gathered, it's scattered. That's what John Wimber used to say. That's what we need to be, a people always on the move, which means, amongst everything else, we have more to learn all the time. Every day of our life, there's something more to learn. Every year of our life, there's something more to learn. Just today, in my Lectio 365 prayer thing, which I do not every day, but quite frequently, the prayer that you'll all be familiar with was there at the beginning of the day's prayers. Jesus, help me to see you more clearly, to love you, and to follow you day by day. There's always more, friends. There's always more. So as we read scripture, as we seek to have an encounter with God, we should expect not to be left the same as we are right now. Sometimes that'll be very discomforting. I guess that Abraham was pretty discomforted, both by this conversation and other things that happened along the way. But he was prepared for that discomfort for the sake of being close to the living God. And we will need to be prepared to have a degree of discomfort in our personal lives and in our church life if we're really to stay in step with the Spirit and keep moving on, even as he keeps moving on. Now, this isn't a message. This word is not about him changing the message. It might be more about the way in which we appreciate the message, because the message is always the same. Which takes me to the next book of the Bible, the book of Exodus. That's surprising. I moved very quickly, didn't it? So in Exodus, you remember this story? Moses sees a bush that's burning but not consumed. We have just come back from my sister's funeral. She was married to a Namibian who was one of the founders of the nation of Namibia, gaining its independence from a South African regime back in 1990. For 25 years, he was exiled from the country as a member of SWAPO, seeking its independence. And he went back with my sister as his wife to be one of the founders of the new nation. Namibia is a bit like the desert in Israel. It is barren, barren, barren. It is dry, dry, dry. It is mountains, rocks, and trees. They have seen spontaneous combustion of bushes in places like that. But bushes, when they spontaneously combust, are consumed. Moses' attention was caught by a spontaneous combustion of a bush that wasn't being consumed. So he watched it for a while. Then he walked towards it, and he knew that something supernatural was happening. And he has a conversation with God. And the context is, he's looking around at this bush that's not being consumed, alongside these rocks, which have been there for centuries, alongside these mountains, which have been there before he and his ancestors and ancestors' ancestors had ever been born. And if you're in a rural, undeveloped nation, as Namibia relatively recently was, they are very, very aware of the mountains and the rocks preceding their life. So he has a little conversation with God, which is a bit like knock, 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 knock. Amos. A mosquito. So he's going knock, knock. Who? I am. I am who I am. Which means that everything you see around me I precede. And everything you see around me reflects me to some degree. Namely, I am consistent and unchanging. I am who I am. Which means for readers, leaders of churches, those leading Bible studies and everybody else, nothing we say about God changes God. It may be true, or it may not be true, but God is true to himself for generation to generation. Which is why I say the message doesn't change, because God doesn't change. But the way we present it might change. The way we congregate as churches might change. But the fundamental message of Exodus is, I am who I am. Of course, those of you who are scholars will know that it could also be translated, I will be who I will be. Does that mean God is going to change? No, that means I will demonstrate to you in the future who you will need to know me, know as I am in the future. So when the people are sick, God reveals himself as, I am the Lord who heals. At that moment, they needed to know what this God was really like. So he says, he is Jehovah Rapha, which means, I am the Lord who heals. At another moment, they need to know that he's the God who will provide for them. Jehovah Jireh, I am the Lord who provides. At another moment, they need to know, when they're faced with their own sin, that he is the Lord who will make them holy. Jehovah Chikedo, I am the Lord who's righteous and will make you righteous. And this is true for us in our lives as we live our lives. We meet the Lord, we know he's unchanging, but we don't know everything about him. There's always more to learn of him, closer to get to him, new experiences in life where we'll need to know how absolutely trustworthy he is in a way we've never known before. So some of you will know that 16 years ago I had a heart attack and I had a cardiac arrest. And there's a lovely phrase in the book of Nehemiah, which is, the gracious hand of the Lord was upon me. And actually the gracious hand of the Lord was upon me when I had my heart attack, because my daughter was alerted to how serious this was, and she rang the medics and they arrived. And Anne had had a dream the night before and knew she was going to have to pray for me in a way she'd never prayed for me in her life before. And she found herself praying for me in a way she'd never prayed for me in her life before. And so I recovered, thanks to the Lord and the medics and the defibrillator, which, having been used by the paramedic in a conversation with Anne, because I was out of it still, she said, oh, I'm so relieved that worked. It's the first time I've ever used it. My sister arrived from where she was living at the time with my brother-in-law, because he was the ambassador in Belgium at the time, Namibian ambassador in Belgium. And she arrived with a hand typed out load of Psalms. She'd typed them out because when she had a heart condition 2 years before, she had sought the Lord in a way she hadn't done for many years in her Christian life. She had been converted as a late teenager. She'd drifted somewhat. She'd even flirted with agnosticism and near atheism. And then in a moment of crisis in her life, she started reading the Psalms and discovered it was in the Psalms that there were prayers about the Lord being her helper, the Lord delivering her from the pit, the Lord hearing her cry and saving her. And these became her prayers, and the Lord comforted her with those prayers. And then in my time of seeking to recover from my heart attack, she came to comfort me with the very words with which the Lord had comforted her. None of us will invite the difficulties in life that we will inevitably go through. It is mostly in the difficulties of life that we will discover new things about God. In our moment of acutest need, God reveals most, and it becomes most revolutionary both for us and subsequently into the lives of others if we allow him to speak through our experience into the experience of others. Revelation becomes revolutionary. Where are we? We're landing soon. How many have I done? Three of the five books here, haven't I? Do you want another one? You see, one of the problems that we often have as Christians is that we're accused of making laws for other people, which neither we nor they can really obey. I mean, have you tried obeying the book of the law? Have you? Anybody find it possible to obey the book of the law? I mean, there are some things that we don't have to obey any longer. So I shouldn't imagine in many of our churches that you sacrificed any animals on Sunday. And that's because, you know, we don't no longer have to do that. But, you know, the moral requirements of the law are still the moral requirements of God. He's not changing his moral purity, holiness. So we all find it impossible. So how can we ever be holy? What has the book of Leviticus got to say to us with all of those laws? If we really read those laws out to people, they just feel condemned, as we feel condemned when we actually immerse ourselves in the law of God. Do you understand what I'm saying there? Do you empathize with me as I'm saying that? No, it's just I feel guilty, but you don't. Okay. This is what it says in Leviticus. He's always at work in us. So set yourselves apart to be holy. That's still his requirement. For I am the Lord your God. Keep all my decrees by putting them into practice. Impossible. For I am the Lord who makes you holy. God is not so much a lawmaker as a relationship maker. And very often we can preach law when actually what we need to be preaching is relationship with a God who will make us holy. It's a strange thing. The more I focus on the law, the more I find it difficult to obey it. In contrast, the more I focus on Jesus, the more I fall in love with him, and the easier it is I find it to do what he asks me to do. That's coming back to, do we keep people in shame, or do we release people into the wonder of a loving relationship and the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit in their life, making them the holy people of God. Fifth book. Numbers. Oh no, I thought I'd done three. I've only just done three now, haven't I? Can you move on to Deuteronomy, the last one, 16, slide 16, and then I'm going to come back to Numbers. I realize I'm doing this in the wrong order of the Pentateuch, but I just suddenly think it might fit in better, because this follows on. God is also always loving. You belong to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be his own special people. It goes on to say, not because you are numerous. He's just chosen you to be his own special people. It was simply that the Lord loves you, and he's keeping the oath he'd sworn to your ancestors. Friends, readers, leaders, Bible study leaders, everybody. He's not chosen you because you're great, or you're obedient, or you've got it all together. He's chosen you because he loves you. Thank you, Father, for loving me. As a child, I receive your love. Thank you, Father, for loving me as a child. I receive your love. Friends, please don't overcomplicate Christianity. Don't lay burdens either on yourself or your friends who are believers or those who aren't yet believers. It's very simple. Father, thank you for loving me. Recovering from my heart attack, which, you know, when you have a cardiac arrest, the blood basically doesn't go to your brain for a while. And although I wasn't out for too long, I did find it hard for a while to string sentences together that made any sense. You'll discover that's still one of my problems. But, you know, it took me a while to put sentences together. And one of the consequences of that, I didn't quite know how to pray. And partly because having sort of been put out once when my heart stopped, I probably was finding it, that was probably the reason why I was finding it hard to go to sleep sometimes at night. And I wanted to pray, but I didn't know how to pray because I didn't put the phrases together in my mind. I found myself praying the most profound prayer repeatedly of my life at that point. Thank you that you love me. I love you. Thank you that you love me. I love you. Revelation becomes revolutionary. And the last little one from the Pentateuch, just to do all five justice. And then we're going to have some music to help us with this one. Go back to slide 14, please, John. Thanks. God is always blessing. I don't know how many of you were listened to once or more than once or frequently the song that was put together around this Aaronic blessing, which comes in Numbers. All of these verses would have been read as the book of the law was read. All of these brought revelation, reminding them, or for the first time showing them some aspect of the true living God, and it became revolutionary in their lives. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And then it went on, whenever Aaron and his sons bless the people of Israel in my name, God said, I myself will bless them. So when we speak words of blessing over people, God himself says, I will bless them. So who believes in the priesthood of all believers? You're good Reformed Protestants here, okay? So you stand in the line of the Levites, the high priest Jesus, and now you are to speak blessing over everyone you meet. And the Lord says, when you bless people with these types of blessings, he says, when you speak that blessing, I myself will bless them. The Lord doesn't necessarily bless before using us to speak those words. He says, if you speak those words, I will bless. The two, we and the living God, join together to bring his blessing. That is his desire. We're his mouthpiece. We speak the words, he blesses. Oh, isn't that a fantastic thought? And this is for you, and it's for your children, and it's for your children's children. One of the joys we have now, Anne and I, at our age, as many of you have, will be as grandparents. And we find ourselves now part of a church where our son-in-law, one of our sons-in-law, is working as the youth worker. And for various reasons, two of our children who are also in North London have now also joined that church with their children. And so we asked whether we could go to their church too now. And so we are there with three of our children, their spouses, and our children's children. So having had our own children in our hands and arms in worship, longing for them 30 years ago, that God would bless them as he's blessed us, we now have our grandchildren in our arms, longing for God's blessing, not just on our children, but on our children's children. And if Jesus tarries, it is God's desire that it will be a blessing upon your children's 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 children to 1,000 generations. This is our God. And when we see him like this, it becomes revolutionary for ourselves. As the people of God together, not just for an individual, engaged in the mission of God together to see a nation changed. I want you to receive this blessing and to imagine yourself speaking this blessing over your family, over your neighbors, including those who don't yet know the Lord. So let's play this, receive a blessing, and then think of passing the blessing on. Because as you know, the mark of being blessed is not the receiving. In the Bible, the mark of the blessing is the giving away of the blessing. It's better to give than to receive. You have to receive first, but then it's better to give away the blessing. So I want you to receive a blessing and be prepared to give the blessing away. So let's just play this for a moment or two, and then we're going to start do some praying.
Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. Children, his presence will be before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you.
Who can ascend the hill of the Lord? Only those with pure heart and clean hands. Cleanse us afresh, we pray, O Lord, for we truly want to see you more clearly, draw closer to you, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly. So we pray, Spirit of the living God, that you do your work in us tonight to free us from our lack of love for you and for the lost, to cleanse us from the things that have stained us and separated us. Holy Spirit, we want you to work your works of power tonight, so that working from the inside out, you will make us your holy people who will carry your presence with joy everywhere we go. I wonder whether you'd stand with me, please, if you're able to. Surely the Lord is here. And we might say, His Spirit is with us. Now my prayer just then was the Spirit would work from the inside out. The Spirit is described in Scripture often as breath or wind. If you are longing for the Spirit of God to work in you from the inside out, then imagine breathing in the Spirit right now. To transform you from one degree of glory to another. To release from shame and to lead into joy. To reach into your present experience and reveal fresh truth about the immutable faithfulness of God. Holy Spirit, fill us from the inside out, we pray. You know, as I've been speaking, I know that some of you have probably been having a little snooze. Others have listened to one part of the message, and others have listened to another part of the message. That's the Spirit applying something that I've been talking about generally to you specifically. Scripture says, pray for one another. So how can we not do that? What that means is we pray for one another. I'm explaining it now. What that means is we pray for one another. What that means is we don't leave the building before we've prayed for one another. So friends, we're going to pray for one another. Don't be so afraid. This is what we do. We pray for one another in the presence of God. And if two of you agree, Jesus says, it will be done. Now, some of you might like to come to the front, and there's a trained prayer ministry team that's going to be here at the front. And whatever you sense that God has been speaking to you about this evening, then that's something to say to them, and they will pray with you that that very thing that you think that God has been doing is done in your life. Some of you will start doing that right now, and I'm going to encourage you right now to start coming forward for that. The prayer ministry team are here. Some of you know you cannot leave tonight before you've dealt with something before God. That's what the weeping was about in part, and that's what the release into joy is about as well. So some of you start making your way forward now, if you will, please. The Spirit of God is resting on many of you right now. Don't miss out on this opportunity. They look frightening, but they're not really. We pray for one another. We pray for one another. Lord, thank you that there's always more. We're praying for individuals, we're praying for us as a community together. We're praying for the diocese that you'd lead us into the more. Thank you that the more from you is always good. It is always for blessing. It is always loving. It is always wooing and winning. We pray for the more. And I can see the Spirit of God resting on many of you where you're standing. You're standing, your eyes closed in a place of stillness, and you're thinking, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. But it's difficult for you to come to the front, and you may never have done that before, and you may not want to do it tonight. But I'm going to ask you, if you will, if you're willing to do this. Any Christians here? We pray for one another. If you're having a little conversation with the Lord right now, don't let me interrupt it. But if you're not, if this is just a sort of relaxed moment, but you're not really having a conversation with the Lord in it, I'm going to ask you to look around to see if there is anybody near you who's still standing there with their eyes closed. Remember, what the Levites did was they explained what was happening as the law was being read, and I'm trying to explain to you what's happening right now. Some people are having a serious conversation with God about something that God has touched them with tonight. So I'm trying to help you to see what the Father is doing. So look around again, see if there's somebody with their eyes still closed. And if there is, then this is the moment that you could say to them, can I pray for you? If they say, and they're perfectly entitled to say, push off, then you push off. But if they say yes, then you're basically asking God to bless them. Can we do that? Can we try doing that? Ooh, a little bit of hesitancy here. If you're having that conversation with the Lord, keep your eyes closed. If you're willing for somebody to just ask whether they can pray for you, keep your eyes closed. But if you've got your eyes open and you're looking around, ask that person with their eyes closed, may I pray for you, please? So I can see a number of people with their eyes closed and nobody's yet asking them that question. Person next to you may have their eyes closed. Can I pray for you? A bit difficult to see with the light like this, actually, as I'm looking around. Friends, you know it says carrying one another's burdens. Do you know the song, you know, about being burdened? We take it to the Lord in prayer. We take it to the Lord in prayer. Carrying one another's burdens is partly about praying for one another. Why should any of us have to face the burdens of life on our own? God doesn't intend that. We were never made to be islands to ourselves. He places us in church, communities, the family of God, the people of God together. And he says, pray for one another. So if you'd like somebody to pray for you tonight, I'm going to suggest right now that you close your eyes. You may have been not wanting this up to this point, but this is another moment. If you'd like somebody to pray for you where you are, just close your eyes again. Now, people of God, look around, and if there's somebody near you that's got their eyes closed, say, can I pray for you?
Please do look around. And if there are folks with their eyes closed, please do, if you feel comfortable to pray with them, just ask the Lord to really meet with them and bless them in this moment.
Now, some of those people, I can see one here at the end of a row, just got their hands open in front of them. That's a very open posture that basically says, I'm wanting the Lord. I'm wanting help. There's somebody like that near you with their eyes closed, their hands open. Don't be afraid of saying, can I pray for you? I can see a lady at the end of the row, just sort of third away back. Nobody, as far as I'm aware, has gone to her. Could somebody just go and say that? That's it. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Please don't leave anyone who's got their eyes closed, because they're really asking for somebody close to them to pray with them. So do look around, and just a simple prayer asking the Lord to come close to them.
It's really quite difficult to see who's got their eyes closed at this distance from people with the light shining into our eyes. So that's why I'm just waiting a little bit for people to have the courage to turn to each other. I can't point everybody out because I can't see. Remember what I said about the Welsh revival? That's in the story I read out. It happens spontaneously. This is not quite spontaneous yet, but it's the people together rather than it just being done by what might look like professionals at the front. When the people together so meet with God that they carry each other's burdens in prayer, that's when there's a sort of spontaneous combustion, which means that something really revolutionary begins. So I hope that we'll have some more time to do that in the nights ahead of us together.
There are two other groups of people that I just sense that maybe the Lord wants to meet with tonight. I was thinking during the worship of a friend, a good friend. He and I were in theological college together in the year 1988, training for ministry. And he had grown up in the church. He knew a lot about God. He was training to be ordained. But he came to some of us one evening and he said that he didn't actually really know Jesus. And he wanted to give his life to Jesus. And the next day in college chapel, when he was leading worship, he led us all in singing the little hymn, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So. It might be, it just might be, that there are really good people here this evening who've been part of the church for decades, for a long time, and you know a lot about church, but you really want to come to know Jesus in a deep way, in a living way. And tonight could be a night where you just ask Jesus to live in your life and to be the Lord of your life. It's his kingdom, to allow him to be king in your life, ruler in your life, as you just repent that you need him. Need his forgiveness. He died for you. As you believe in him. Don't want to embarrass anyone, but if that's where you're at tonight, I know some of the folks at the front would love you to come forward before you go home and would love to pray with you. But there's a lot of us here tonight, and I'm one of them, who's desperate to see people come to know Jesus. Amen. And to see our communities and our towns and villages and cities changed because people come to know Jesus. And if you want just a fresh anointing of God's Spirit to do the work of evangelism. Standing where you are, would you acknowledge that by just holding your hands open? I can ask everybody else to close their eyes in this moment. And Lord, I pray that you would increase in your church that gift of evangelism. But Lord, that you would enable all of us to do the work of evangelism, that you would enable all of us, Lord, just to speak to friends and neighbors and strangers about Jesus, to tell them the story of the cross. God, equip your church to lead the lost to Jesus. Yes. Equip your people here this evening. Pour out upon us your Holy Spirit in a fresh way. Lord, that we would be those who know what it means for people around us to be lost without Christ. And Lord, put in our hearts just a longing and a desire to lead them to Jesus, to show them the way, to tell them the truth, and to point them to the cross. Equip all of us, particularly those who are crying out to you, Lord, in this moment and saying, yes, yes, yes. Yes. Enable me to lead people to Christ. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. I'd love to encourage us to be here on as many nights as we can. Tomorrow evening we'll be commissioning in a fresh way our diocesan lay readers. And on Thursday evening, our clergy team in the diocese will be renewing the vows that we made some of us many years ago when we were ordained a deacon, a presbyter, or a priest, or even bishop. I want us tonight as well to take a moment to pray for somebody who had wanted to be with us. And John has stepped in. But Ben Quashie was to be here this year with us, and he's currently recovering from surgery and treatment for cancer. And we pray healing, healing, and blessing for Ben, and peace and strength for Gloria. Presence of God to visit those that they lead in ministry and in mission. I'm going to ask the band to lead us in one more song, and then we'll draw our evening to a close. The prayer team will be around, particularly if you want tonight. I sometimes say in the Church of Ireland, it's like there are folks, and you know, you've written in your name in God's book in pencil. But if the Lord was to come back, do you really know him? Take down the fountain pen. Write it in an ink. Make sure that you've given your life to Christ, that you've acknowledged your need of a Savior who died for you and for me, and that you're believing and trusting in what he has done, not even in the old Church of Ireland, but on what Christ has done for us on the cross. We worship together.
the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the world. So we sing, praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King. The dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father of this world. And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit made the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not fear and shall not fade. By His blood and His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Calvary love of God, the fellowship and companionship and presence of God the Holy Spirit be with us all. And the blessing of God Almighty, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you and with those you love and those for whom you pray this night and always. Amen. No need to rush off, folks, but you're free to go if you choose to do so, and see you, God willing, tomorrow evening.